Hello and welcome to the Toledo Lucas County Public Library's Sight and Sound Video History Project. I'm Tom Walton. When we talk about the history of Toledo and Lucas County, we have to talk about the history of the working man and woman. And in agriculturally rich Lucas County, that means the people who work in our farm fields. And today we have an opportunity to learn about the struggles they faced with poor wages and intolerable living and working conditions. And we'll get to know the man who lived with those struggles and did something about it. His name is Baldemar Velasquez, and he is the founder and president of the Farm Labor Organizing Committee, or FLOC. And Baldemar, thanks for sitting down with us. Always great to be with you.
Pleasure, Tom.
We've known each other a long time. I was trying to remember exactly how long. I first met you back in the 1960s, somewhere in the late 1960s, when FLOC was just getting off the ground. But we were both a lot younger then.
I guess so.
And we'll talk about those days in a bit, but I want to start by going back a bit farther to your childhood. You were born in a small town in Texas, Farr, Texas, I think, P-H-A-R-R.
That's correct.
In 1947. Where exactly is Farr, Texas?
Right across the river from Reynosa, Mexico. McAllen is next door. And then San Juan is on the other side. It's known as that whole corridor right along the valley, along the river, is known as the longest main street in the world, because the town sort of grew together. Adana, Weslaco, all the way down to Brownsville, San Benito, Harlingen. They've sort of all grown together. So that was my home.
But your heritage is Mexican, but you were born in the United States.
Yes. My grandparents came from San Luis Potosí on my mother's side. They were fleeing the ravages of the Mexican Revolution in the 1910s, and they came over on a train to get away from the violence. And my mom and dad were both born in Texas. My mom was born on this side of the river. Her older sisters were born in Mexico.
Okay. Your parents were
Crescencio
and Vicenta Velasquez.
Right.
And they raised 9 children. Six boys, 3 girls. What are your memories of your mother and father and what they meant to you and your siblings during those early years?
Survival. I mean, they did what they had to do to survive. In those years, the outlook for Mexican people was, you know, was delegated to working in the fields, the drudgery jobs, and my earliest memory is not understanding at that time. This was the backdrop of the civil rights movement and the burgeoning civil rights movement in the 1950s. We could still remember seeing those derogatory signs on restaurants: "No Mexicans or dogs allowed." I remember Dad having to send my oldest brother, Junior, to the back window of a restaurant to buy hamburgers to take out when we were traveling on those two-lane highways with 50-mile-an-hour speed limits. So, and trying to travel from Texas to Ohio, Ohio to Texas, with a carload of kids, no air conditioning in those days. So it was pretty tough, but always looking, you know, for work, for jobs. I know that my mom and dad tried the sharecropping bit in Texas, south of Robstown, Texas. Tried it for a year and a half or two, and they just couldn't make it in that. And so they would follow the crops in Texas with my mom's family. The cotton harvest, all the way from North Texas, then back down to the Bay Area, and I got a taste of that when I was about 9 years old. One of the few opportunities we had to go from Ohio back to Texas, we got stranded in Ohio, so my mom had missed seeing her mom, and my dad finally got us together to go down and join them in the cotton harvest in North Texas, up near Tulia, near the Panhandle, and then we traveled with them down to the Gulf and and picked cotton. I worked alongside my grandfather for a few weeks. So
now, at what point did your family leave Texas behind and move permanently to Ohio?
Well, that was the, I imagine it had to been around 53, 52 or 53, mm-hmm. When we came to Ohio and we got stranded in up in Port Clinton. We didn't make enough money to get back. I think mom and dad, one of them got sick, and you know, we weren't able to do get the ride back to Texas from the crew leaders at that time that transported us in the back end of the trucks. I remember the first trip to Ohio, the back end of a flatbed truck with wooden sideboards and a canvas thrown over the top. There'd be five or six families crammed in the back there, and I remember, you know, huddling next to my mom, trying to keep warm, and the back of that truck to Ohio. And then either we didn't make enough money or one of my parents got sick, so we had to spend our first winter in the Port Clinton area. And we had no idea how cold it was up here. So in Texas, we didn't have heaters in our home. Mm-hmm. It just got cold, just throw in another blanket. We had to move the family into the kitchen where we lived that first winter, because our heat source was the oven from the stove.
Oh my goodness.
And yeah. So I started going to school. I didn't know any English. I started going to school because it was warm in the schoolhouse and cold at home. And little by little, I picked up a few words of English, and by the end of that first year, I learned a little bit of English, and then we...
And you were how old then?
About six.
Six.
So next summer, we had to work for free for the summer for the farmers that loaned money to my dad all winter to stay alive. And just it seemed like from then on, it was just a constant struggle just to get out of debt, you know, pay off the debt. My dad was... never ran away from debt. He said, we got to pay it back, And the only way jobs that we had were fuel jobs. So we were out there hoeing sugar beets, the corn, the soybeans, and then the harvest.
So as young as age six, you were out there in the fields.
Yeah, I remember our first job was picking potatoes with another family. At that time, you got paid by the acre of potatoes. It was like $30 an acre, $35 an acre. It's a lot of potatoes in an acre. And just trailer loads of potatoes and then tomatoes and all the other crops, the hoeing jobs. And all through my grade school years and high school, but there was a silver lining in all of that you stayed in school and you learned more English. Mm-hmm. By the time I was about the third or fourth grade, I knew enough English to really pick up on what the teachers were talking about. And but every summer was a struggle to pay the winter debt.
Now, your family settled, I think, in Gilboa,
we Ohio, eventually moved,
in Putnam County?
Yeah, that was where we made our longest length of living, right on the county line between Hancock and Putnam County, and went to school there.
Now, do you remember when you first encountered racism?
It was always such a subtle thing, and there wasn't a term for it. You knew that the people kept you arm's distance, and a lot of times you didn't feel welcome.
Let me ask you about something that we spoke about briefly before we began. When I recounted that I remember your nickname used to be Baldy, and I'm guilty of calling you that in our early years together, because everybody else was, it seemed at the time. But you were relating how that was troubling. And can you share that story with us, how that happened?
Well, it was an undercurrent of irritation, but they were like bigger issues to fight. So you let some things roll off your back, but a lot of times, especially with the early Mexican families, the Anglos had a hard time pronouncing the kids' Mexican names. So they shortened it and anglicized their names. One of my buddies made a whole song of these things. He said, we had this guy named Domingo Nieve, and so the Anglo, instead of using his name Domingo, or Mingo is the short term that Mexican people use, they called him Ice Cream Sunday. And so a lot of names were, there's like degenerate derivations of those names that because the Angles are either too lazy or didn't want to learn about somebody else's, you know, culture or, and so that was always a source of irritation, because Baldemar, the short in Mexican is Balde, and so that Balde became Baldy to the Anglos, and they made fun of it and so on, but there were, like, to me, always bigger issues to fight.
How did it make you feel personally, as a child still, to encounter that?
Well, I mean, the larger overt acts of racism, it made you want to fight. Mm-hmm. So you're always fighting for respect. I mean, all kids want to be part of the group. They want to be accepted. I wasn't any different. And so I had a way to ventilate that anger through sports. So I went out, I played everything there was to play, just because I wanted to get even with somebody, or use that hostility that I had about that, and took it out playing sports. And I was a decent athlete because I worked hard, and in football especially, you get hit people and get away with it. So,
helped to vent some of that frustration.
It did. Yeah, that's true.
I find it fascinating that you said when you were in grade school, to go back just a bit again, that you virtually taught yourself English by listening and observing and watching and learning and in class. So you got passed along from the first grade to the second right. to the third, without really knowing the language.
Not a whole lot. In those days, there weren't any bilingual programs or compensatory education programs or special ed, that sort of thing. Either, you know, they just, I assume that they thought these are migrant families, they're going to be gone anyway, just pass them along and, you know, they'll be gone and eventually. But there was one life-changing event that occurred. I was just gotten into the seventh grade, and I was a C-D student. I was barely getting by. I remember one of the football games that I was playing in. It was a seventh and eighth grade team, and I was playing halfback, both on defense and offense. And this particular game, I'd scored, I don't know, three touchdowns. I'd done real well that day, so I was walking off the field feeling pretty good about myself. When one of the Anglo kids' teammates comes up to me and says, "Hey, Velasquez, you're a pretty good athlete, but look at your grades, you're still a dumb Mexican." And that sort of, my anger went, you know, I restrained myself. I didn't do anything. I wanted to smash him with my football helmet. But I remember taking a dictionary from the school library, taking it home, and looking up every word I couldn't understand in English. I knew there was I had an Ohio history test coming up, and I stayed up till 2-3 o'clock in the morning until I understood every word that was written in those chapters, and I aced that test. And by the end of the school year, I was on the honor roll. So from that on, I kept that dictionary closed and looked up every word that I had to, and that's the way I built my vocabulary.
So in an ironic way, your teammate probably did you a bit of a favor.
He did me a big favor. So then I, you know, was able to stay on the honor roll through high school and not let that impact me, and sort of made a vow that nobody would ever call me a dumb Mexican again.
Yeah. You worked in the fields with your family for a long, long time. Can you give us some sense of what that was like, the heat, the rain, the humidity, the sweat, the toil, the whole package, with children in the fields, you and your siblings? What was it like?
Well, we didn't know any better. We didn't know what to compare it.
It was the life you had.
Compare it to. This was life. This is just the way life is. And the worst part of the heat you could take, but the elements that mix with the heat is, you know, all the dust, for instance, the bugs, the mosquitoes. Like you're picking strawberries up in Messick, Michigan. We'd migrate up there the early part of the year to pick strawberries before we go into the cherry harvest. And in the morning, you had to get out the earliest possible, because the farmer would make his quota by 2 o'clock for the day, because it's fresh market fruit. And so you had to get out there at daybreak. And at daybreak, there's a lot of moisture dew on the plant. So you're soaked at the bottom, and then the mosquitoes are terrible. And then as soon as it starts getting hot, and then on top of the heat dries you off, and then your everything from your shins on down is caked with dry mud, and you're just have to keep your hands moving as fast as you can, because in those days, you know, they didn't keep hours to guarantee your minimum wage, even though there was a minimum wage for farm workers, but everything was piece rate. Yeah. You only got paid for what you picked, so yeah. The whole family was out there trying to make ends meet.
Now, did you live in the camps with Yes. your family? What were living conditions like?
Well, there was everything from chicken coops to barns and converted shacks, you know, anything to just throw people in with a roof over your head. There was only one time that my dad refused to stay in a place. A farmer wanted to put us in a, it was actually a stall in a barn, and next door were hogs on the other side, you know, just thin boards between the two. And my dad said, no, I'm not going to put my family in there. But we lived in some pretty shabby places. Best thing we could do, like an old abandoned schoolhouse. I remember one time up there, they cut the they put up plywood boards in four parts and put a family in each in an old abandoned schoolhouse. So our family had a space not bigger than this room where the cameras are, the two walls, and we had to eat, sleep, bathe, wash, cook, all in that area of space. So whatever bedding we had on the floor, well, just on the whatever floor there was, if it was concrete or wood, we had pick up what we slept on that night and put it off to the side so we can have area to cook and eat and so on. And best thing you could do when you moved in, sweep it out as clean as you could, and try to set up some nominal living quarters. And you go out every day and you come back, and it was a tough thing to come back to after a hard day's work, but we didn't know any better. We thought that's just the way life is. Yeah. And that's the way it was with everybody else that traveled with us.
Now, you graduated from high school when?
65.
From Gilboa?
Pandora High School.
Okay. And you entered what was then still called, I think, Bluffton College. How was college possible, given your large family?
It wasn't. I was a senior in high school, and I had no inclination to going to college. My high school literature teacher, a guy named George Vance, said, "Where are you going to college?" I said, "College, never thought. I thought college was for white people." And he said, "Well, your grades are good enough. You ought to think of going to college." So by the time I got around to looking where I can go to college, middle of my high school senior year, the only places I could go to, I could have gone to Bluffton or Heidelberg. I remember looking into those schools, but there was no way I could afford it. Mm-hmm. And even I didn't know a whole lot about financial aid. Didn't know anything about it. The only school I could afford to go to was Pan American College down in South Texas. And that summer, Dad took the family down to visit my mom's mother, and I checked the college there. It's in Edinburgh, Texas. It's like 9 miles from far. And I said, this could be workable. I could go to school here, live with my grandparents there, and figure out a way to get to school every day. So actually, I got through my first two semesters with $750, out-of-state tuition, books, and everything. And of course, living with my grandparents helped with the living part. And I hitchhiked to school every morning, those 8 or 9 miles. And it was easy. It was faster than taking a bus, because the 281, it goes from the Rio Grande Valley to San Antonio. Edinburgh is the first, you know, big town out of the valley. And so my grandparents' house was like 4 blocks from 281. So I just walked those 4 blocks over to 281, stick my thumb out, and all the farm worker families going to work in the fuels that day, going north on 281. Any kid with books along 281 going north knows going to college there. So
no trouble getting.
No trouble. I get picked up within 5 minutes of standing out there. That was pretty cool because I said, "Muchacho, vas a la universidad, súbete, vámonos." You know, get in, throw in the back, get in the back with all their kids, and they gave me a ride to Edinburgh, so it was easy getting to school.
Mm-hmm. And how you ended up at Bluffton, though, at some point after that?
Fortunately, Pan American was a good science school. Pan American was one of the 7 Earth-based satellite tracking stations for NASA, and I was going to be an engineer. So I took all the math courses, and my lab was going to the desert on Wednesday nights and getting a teletype message from NASA. Our class would, and we set the coordinates to the telescope out in the desert and NASA would flash the satellite 7 times to see how many we could photograph. And I loved it, but being in South Texas, you couldn't help but notice all the discrimination and all the racism against Mexican people. Here we are, 80% of the population, and all of the mayors, all of the elected officials were all white. I said, how is this? And of course, this was when the Civil Rights Movement was getting very public. And so the social issues began to take over my life. And then to watch the way my aunts were being treated in public places. I'd go with them on weekends to do shopping and things like that. And just the way the discrimination against Mexican people was so glaring that even if you were unschooled in civil rights or anything like that, you couldn't. I said, this is compounds what the subtle things that I experienced in the North. And so I began to get more interested in the social sciences. So the following year, I transferred to Ohio Northern University. I don't know if you remember Judge Joe Flores. Mm-hmm. Well, Judge Joe Flores was a graduate at Ohio Northern University. And he got me together with a priest there, the parish priest there in Ada. And he helped me get arranged a loan, a school loan, to transfer to Ohio Northern.
Okay.
And then it was from Ohio Northern that I made my jump to Bluffton College my junior year.
Okay, and in the back of your mind, it sounds like this is about the time a dream was formulating. Given your life's experiences to that point and what you'd encountered in South Texas and so forth, at the age of 20, I think you were just 20, you founded what we know as FLOC, the Farm Labor Organizing Committee. Was that an idea that had begun percolating at that point in your mind for some time?
Well, from the time I was maybe 11, 12 years old, I've always wanted to do something about the conditions out there because being in school, I began to measure things based on what other people's experiences were. And then I saw that this was not the only world that there was. All this was, the undercurrent of all of this was, it got me involved in the civil rights movement, in the student rights movement at that time, especially at Ohio Northern University. So my Christmas vacation winter of maybe 66, 67, I volunteered to work for CORE, Congress for Racial Equality in Cleveland. So I moved in into a tenement house with this black blind man, who happened to be named Richard Burton, and it was easy to remember that name. He lived on the 3rd or 4th floor of this old tenement house in the Huff section of Cleveland that burned down about 3 months after I left there, part of the national riots and everything. So I was sleeping on his couch in the living room, and my job was to ride shotgun with another African American, and we had a police scanner in the car, and our job was to respond to police calls and document police brutality cases in the black community. And every night I'd go home to Mr. Burton's house and walk up those flights of stairs, and you know, I'd sleep on his couch. And one morning we're eating grits one morning, and he says, son, I gotta ask you, a question, and I said, "You're the only volunteer that I ever had here that hasn't complained about the rats. Why is that?" And I said, "Oh, I grew up with the rats. And as a matter of fact, my brother Joe and I used to play with the rats because we didn't have any toys when we were little kids and living in migrant labor camps." So I explained to him my life growing up and explained to him how we, there was a story that I tell my kids has become a very popular storytelling time and that I tell the kids sometimes. Is that my brother Joe and I shared our sleeping quarters at home was the living room couch. He slept on one end and I slept on the other end. And that couch was up against a window overlooking the front porch of that old house in Putnam County on the county line. And there was a crack under the pane where the rats would come in from the outside and then scratch themselves up the back of the couch. And when we hear that scratching up there, we knew there was a rat up on top there. And in order for the rat to get to the floor, it had to jump down on the seat where we were sleeping to get down to the floor. So when we'd hear that scratching noise, we'd kick each other and pull the blankets taut to kind of make a trampoline out of our blanket. And when the rat would come down there, we'd go, boom, hit it underneath, see how far we could make the rat fly. That was our game, see how far we could make the rat fly. And when I told Mr. Burton that story, he says, "Good Lord, son, why aren't you doing something for your own people?" And that was a question that hung over my head the rest of the semester at Ohio Northern University. So I started thinking, well, I need to organize the farm workers. And actually, I used the Farm Labor Organizing Committee. What I thought of at that time is that we have to make this like a civil rights movement for Latinos, for farm workers. And I mistakenly thought that all we had to do was notify the authorities that certain laws weren't being enforced. The health regulations for migrant camps, and we just report these bad conditions that somebody would do something about them.
Didn't work, did it?
No, it didn't work. And so the FLOC, the Farm Labor Organizing Committee, I sort of patterned it after the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. So that's where I got the name of a committee, mm-hmm. that this would be a movement kind of like a civil rights movement for farm workers. And when that didn't work, we decided, well, then I started studying what other ways, and I started to learn about unions. And I went to every union in Northwest Ohio. I went to the Teamsters, I went to the auto workers, I went to everybody to organize farm workers. Nobody wanted to organize farm workers because of the short-term employment. It's so short. So I said, well, I guess we have to just form one of our own. And that's where the idea came from.
Okay, now, taking the concept of unionism into the fields, did not sit well, as you well remember, and I well remember, with many farmers and growers and packers in those early years. Were you surprised by the level of resentment you encountered at the beginning?
Yes and no. I mean, what I sense was underneath everything before that now came out openly, the hostility. I said, that's what these people really thought about us all along. They just, you know, it was just sort of latent underneath. And so the hostility didn't surprise me, because I felt that the senses of racism that was kind of always there, it came out. Of course, the other side, the goodness of some people came out as well, who was able to stand up and say, these people got a right to do these things. Some of the farmers that we worked for instance, many years for, when we started organizing, although many farmers were opposed to it, there were some farmers who we had worked for and said, you folks have a right to do that. Yeah, mm-hmm. I don't blame you for doing that. If I was in your shoes, I'd be doing the same thing.
Mm-hmm. So, as a young labor reporter for the Blade, I remember covering one incident in which shots were fired, Baldemar. Did you accept the notion that your life was at risk and that one day perhaps you might pay a greater penalty for your activism?
You know what, that in those situations you don't think of those things. Mm-hmm. You don't think about it till afterwards. Boy, that was stupid. Why did I put myself in that situation?
Yeah.
You know, I remember being faced with a farmer and his son had a shotgun, and and they were threatening us. And I said, well, you can go ahead and shoot that. And, you know, I remember telling him, I said, you can kill me, but you can't kill the idea. I thought, did I really say that? I mean, it was kind of, I mean, some kid could crazily just haul off and shoot you and maybe not even thought about it. But you don't think about those things when you're in those situations. You don't think about it till later. So there are risks, yeah, and there still are. When I troop around North Carolina right now and our campaign to organize those tobacco workers, and when I'm in Mexico, yeah, we look over our shoulder. We careful of where we go and who we go with and that sort of thing. So there's always that element of danger.
There's never a time, though, where you said this just isn't worth it, obviously. You kept pushing.
Well, I felt that a lot of people raise that issue. Is this really worth it? What you want to do with your life? You can go study, get a good job with your education. I remember arguing with one of my brothers about that. Is that you should be having a job to help mom and dad. And that's true. But somehow I would felt like I was abandoning my own family in the fields, because remember, while I was doing this work, they were still mm-hmm. out there picking crops. And I felt like unless somebody changed something in this, the future generation come in, yep, I can move on and do something else myself. And we've encouraged a lot of Mexican kids to get out of the fields, get their education. A lot of them are off and doing something good now. A lot of them now are excelling in life. But for every person you take out, some other poor guy goes in there and takes their place. So you got to reform the system so that nobody's taken advantage of like that.
Yeah, you might expect that there'd be management resistance to union efforts. Some of that might be understandable. But you've already described how the unions were reluctant to help at the beginning. Did they come around? Did the AFL-CIO, did the UAW, the Teamsters finally take you seriously?
Yeah, of course. Once we had our breakthroughs with Campbell Soup and mm-hmm. some of the other companies, we started to get really good support officially from the unions. The first fight, it was very problematic because we were boycotting a product that wasn't that was partially a union, was considered a union product. But I said somebody had to pick the tomatoes and go in the cans, and they're not union. When we finally got the breakthrough, we made our peace with some of those unions, and they've ended up being good supporters of FLOC over the years.
Did you end up supporting their efforts as well? I mean, was it a two-way street? Did FLOC sometimes walk the lines with some of your brothers and sisters and other unions?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, as a matter of fact, that first agreement with Campbell Soup, that fight had gone on for 8 years. And we were sitting up in Detroit Airport, the hotel there, negotiating with the Campbell's executives from Camden and all their farmers that they brought in. They had to form an association of farmers to facilitate this supply chain agreement that we pioneered in those days. There's been a precedent since then. We were there the whole week, and we finished negotiating. We agreed to everything, ready to type everything up and sign it the next day. And I heard that day that there was a picket line in front of the Campbell's plant in Napoleon. And the building trades were picketing it because they had a non-union builder putting up an evaporating facility where they evaporate all the tomatoes down into a pulp and to for consistency's sake, that to make the juice and soup products from. So I told them I can't sign that agreement until that thing's taken care of over there, because my first act as a union leader would be to allow our members to cross somebody else's picket line. I said, I ain't going to do that, you guys. And I remember Professor John Dunlop, former Secretary of Labor, was chairing this commission and mediating these negotiations. And you had the other commissioners, Doug Frazier, former UAW president, Monsignor George Higgins from the U.S. Catholic Conference, were our commissioners on that particular commission. And I remember Doug Frazier coming into the caucus room to me, just screaming at me. He said, "You got to sign that agreement." And yeah, you spent all this time negotiating. They're going to accuse you of negotiating in bad faith and so on and so on. And I said, "I'm sorry, Doug, but I'm not going to sign that agreement until that picket line's out of there, because I'm not going to cross somebody else's picket line." So I went and back here, closed up our books. I told our guys, "Let's go." And I was going to walk away, continue the fight until, you know, that thing's taken care of. And guy from Campbell's that they assigned to come in and settle this thing walked out the hall and said, "Wait, just wait. Let me give you a call later tonight and to think about coming back in the morning." Okay. He calls me up later that night. "Come on back in the morning. I got something for you." I came back this morning. That thing had been taken care of. They threw out that non-union contractor, put the Northwest Ohio building trades back in there. And at that time, Ray Medlin was the head of the building trades. When he heard what we had done, he became one of my best friends from then on.
I would imagine so, yeah.
So, yeah, we believe in solidarity. We got a solidarity, in a lot of ways, has become a cheap word. It becomes rhetoric in a lot of people, but all solidarity has to count for something. And there's always some sacrifice to it. If there's no sacrifice to it, I'm not sure it's true solidarity. I mean, you got to give up something for somebody else.
Mm-hmm. Now, eventually, in later years, you turned a lot of your attention to North Carolina, pickle industry, Mount Olive Pickle Company in particular. Why did that become important to FLOC?
Mount Olive was the only pickle company that we did not have an agreement with. All the other major pickle companies, Vlasic Pickle, Heinz USA, Dean Foods, their subsidiaries in Northwest Ohio was Antengene Pickle and Green Bay Foods. So we had a collective agreement with all of these companies. But Mount Olive was a flourishing company. They were trying to go national, which undercut the standards that we were pushing for Ohio. Because you get up to a certain time and you got to be competitive in the market. We can't ask our partners to do things that their competitors are not doing. So we had to take on the Mount Olive Pickle Company. And that led us into that fight in North Carolina, which is completely different than organizing up here. They have right to work laws there, and you have to, it's traditional opposition to unions there, more so than anywhere else. It was tough going, so we fought that for almost 5 years before we got that company to agree to a supply chain agreement.
So as we sit here in 2010, Baldemar, how many contracts, how many members does FLOC have today?
We got between 10 and 11,000 under union contract. The numbers vacillate from one year to the next.
In how many states?
Well, let's see, Ohio, Michigan, North Carolina, Virginia. Virginia, I think there's a farm in Tennessee. So those five states.
Okay. Is your membership then at an all-time high?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Changing the subject just a little bit, in 2007, a FLOC associate of yours, Santiago Rafael Cruz, was murdered in Mexico. How did that affect you?
Oh man, it kind of like somebody sucker punched you that blew the wind out, that knocked the wind out of you.
This was someone who was a friend of yours.
He was here for 4 years in Ohio, working, organizing the immigrant population for us.
And he was in Monterrey, Mexico. Yeah. What was he doing there?
His job was to educate workers. At that time, we had encountered a lot of workers that came to us, and not just the workers that we represented with the North Carolina Grower Association, but mostly from these other recruiting outfits that were ripping off workers, extorting, bribing them, because this was a legal way for them to come to the United States and work. So these recruiting companies had access to visas from North American employers. Essentially, some of them were selling them to the highest bidder. So you got a poor guy in the mountains of San Luis Potosí, an Indian village, and desperately needing to work, said his option is to pay a smuggler, you know, $3,000 to get smuggled across, or pay this recruiter. He says, bring me, you know, $1,000 and I'll get you a visa. And so they were paying it up. So Santiago's job was to educate the workers that under this H-2A program, you don't have to pay those fees. The legitimate fees to pay was the fees that you pay for the interview at the American consulate, which at that time was $100, and then $100 for the visa. And then you had to put up the transportation to get here, which you get reimbursed on arrival. That was the rules of the H-2A program at that time. And Santiago's job was to tell them, this is what you're supposed to pay. If they ask you for a penny more, they're asking you too much. They're ripping you off. Don't do it. There's other ways to for you to get the
process. And obviously
process.
He upset somebody greatly.
Well, we were doing that from the time we opened that office. Mm-hmm. We had a previous staff member that was overseeing that office that was filing a lot of grievances on this on the seniority issues. But there was always a tense relationship with those recruiters. And I'm not saying it was the recruiters of our association that were involved in this, but all those other recruiters, if you go to Monterrey, every block there's a recruiting company. And when we're signaling that you have to watch out for these guys and this is what the rules are, they didn't like it. So mm-hmm. there was always people stalking our office, following us on the street. And that stopped when the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, after the assassination, bestowed the status of that this was an official human rights case. Mm-hmm. And they ordered the Mexican government to protect us. So they put some protective measures on, one of which is putting security cameras in our office so that it overlooks the street. And after we did that, the stalking stopped.
But speaking of the Mexican government, in this case, you could not have been satisfied with the lack of enthusiasm for prosecuting this case, right? Is it still unsolved after 3 years?
From the beginning, they did everything they could to sweep it under the rug, make it go away. There was a lot of visibility in the beginning, international visibility, and the oversight of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights keeps it at that level. They moved last year to try to remove the protective measures, saying, you know, that we're not under any more threat. And having that status puts the Mexican government in a bad light. And so we, under Mexican law, victims can assign an attorney to co-prosecute the case. So our attorney has the right to do his own parallel investigation. We keep, you know, bringing more information to the Attorney General's office to pick up, for instance, two of the other accomplices, which have not moved to do. Mm-hmm. Why they haven't done it is beyond our concept of jurisprudence in this country. I mean, if law enforcement officials had to lead in who perpetrators of a crime were, they'd issue a national alert. But in Mexico, it's different. Every attorney general is autonomous. They don't have an integrated mm-hmm. system like we do here. Mm-hmm. So you have to go get their permission to pick up somebody in some other state, and they just drag their feet at it.
So I think you said there's one person who's captured for his role in the...
Yes.
But the others remain at large.
That's right.
After all this time. I remember a conversation with you many years ago about the great community organizer Saul Alinsky and what an influence he had on you. You were talking about that. How did that happen, and what did you learn from Saul Alinsky?
Well, his interest-based organizing has become very widespread, and a lot of people teach it. Industrial Areas Foundation, even other organizing trainers like Gamaliel and others under the concept of, particularly the famous house meeting campaign. Mm-hmm. Fred Ross, the guy that trained Cesar Chavez, came to Ohio 3 summers in a row to train us towards the end of the Campbell Soup fight. And he taught us the fundamentals of that famous house meeting campaign. And frankly, it's what every good organizer, even political organizers, know, that that you engage people one-on-one and you get their personal commitment. You read this in professional fundraising. Mm-hmm. And that's, you got to boil down organizing to one-on-one, whatever strategy you have. So So Fred Ross and the Alinsky model was very key in our education, the making this substance of these campaigns. And so, we sort of like design campaigns using that as a vehicle, the Alinsky style of organizing. But some of the key principles, actually one of the key things that I learned is from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. The only time I ever met him, in that time when I was a senior at Bluffton College, about 3 or 4 months before he was assassinated, I got a telegram at Bluffton College from Dr. King inviting me to come to Atlanta to help plan the Poor People's Campaign. And so I go down to Atlanta, and he invited, 20-some Latino leaders from around the country to participate in his Poor People's Campaign, because Dr. King had a vision that it was no longer, the civil rights was no longer just a black issue, that it was a class issue, as a poor people in general, this white, black, white, brown, and yellow. And he was determined to bring these class of poor people together to do something monumental in terms of reforming the way America looks at these issues and economics and so on. Well, during that discussion, he said something that stuck with me forever. Because the discussion boiled down to, how do we as poor people who have nothing, how do we compel some of the world's largest corporations to sit down and negotiate with us, like we did with Campbell Soup and Heinz USA and so on? I remember succinctly his response. He says, he stood up there in his statuesque style saying, when you impede the rich man's ability to make money, anything is negotiable. And I never forgot that, so that when we study the challenges, we always think about, okay, where is their money chain? Where do they make their money? And how do you disrupt that? How do you, get their attention that way? And that's been really the key of all our campaigns.
Mm-hmm. When I think of Baldemar Velasquez of the 1960s and the early 1970s, I remember the passion, I remember the fire in the belly, and I remember the anger that drove you in those early days. Over the years, a calmness has come over you. What changed?
Well, I think it changed for the better, because at that time there was like a wild striking out and looking for the next way to hammer the opposition. I had a conversion experience in '86, and what changed was not the fire in the gut. What changed was the strategic value of what we were trying to achieve. Because before I had that conversion experience, it was like a power struggle, get even type of thing. How do you get equal with these powerful people? So it was a straight power struggle. After that, it became what the essence of true reconciliation is. I began to understand Gandhi's saying that the objective of nonviolence is to win the opposition over to your side. And the Christian value of true reconciliation, you have to forgive certain things. You have to forgive your enemy in order for you to reconcile with them. And reconciliation, though, doesn't mean close your eyes to the evil, to the bad. It means you have to be honest and put it on the table and deal with it. So I began to equate the struggle in agriculture like you're trying to reconcile a big dysfunctional family, where you got an abusing partner at the top and you got the victims of the family on the bottom, and somehow like a pastor in counseling separates the parties, come out with the truth and talks with them separately about it before he brings them to the table. Okay, here are the issues, and then try to get the parties to reconcile over those conflicts. So to me, that's what the farm worker movement is now. It's a big initiative to reconcile a huge dysfunctional family.
You spoke of your conversion in the 80s. I presume it was that moment, that epiphany for you, when you regard to religion and your relationship with God, and you were born a Catholic, and I think now you are an ordained minister, is that right?
Yeah.
And are you using that in your work?
I do. I use it to obviously pray for families, individual situations, workers in the fields, in labor camps, when the need is there, we pray. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I mean, you have to stand on something, in a belief, you know, for hope, for something better. People have to have hope. And then the union is, it just becomes a vehicle to try to achieve some of those hopes. And again, in a way, so you're not overpowering other people. It's not a question of overthrowing anything. It's a question of reconciling with them. And this is also for the welfare, for the well-being of the oppressor. When you take a corporate executive who's making $16 million a year, and you got a farm worker who's helping create that wealth in the kind of conditions that we described earlier today, I mean, working in those tobacco fields is no picnic. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're swallowing gnats and that hot, humid, working in the valleys with no ventilation. I don't see how really rich people can sleep at night knowing that their wealth is coming from those people who are mm-hmm. stooped over like that. So I think that there has to be a militancy, an insistence that they deal with this.
Yeah. Now, you told The Blade back in 1997 that the person you would most like to meet is Moses. And why did you say Moses?
Because he was the pioneer. He led the Israelites out of Egypt, out of bondage, mm-hmm. and tried hard to make the people believe, to have faith. and people were always doubting and questioning him because people didn't have the desire to go on. They didn't want to put up with the, not leaving a comfortable place. At least they knew where they were going to sleep that night. Rather than wandering in the desert, trying to reach that promised land. And he would be an excellent teacher and master in terms of, you know, dealing with these unruly crowds and people who lack faith. And time and time again, he had to call them back to their obedience to God, mm-hmm. Which in the end, the only ones that survived was Joshua and his crew that crossed into the promised land. And so I always like to think that he would be a good teacher for all of us, particularly in where we are, but understanding that we are the generation of Joshua, the overcomers, that were able to learn those lessons that Moses tried to communicate to the masses.
Have you ever wondered what path your life would have taken, Baldemar, had you not organized FLOC, had you not taken to the fields to organize farm workers? Would ministry ultimately have perhaps been a career, or have you pondered that?
No, actually I haven't.
Could you?
I might have. I would have liked to do more music. I love folk music. And
I know you love to play the guitar.
Play my guitar and, you know, get in there and jam with some other good musicians, and I would like to pursue that even more. Ministering, I think, is a pretty deep-seated sense of my life now. But it's a different kind of ministry, mm-hmm. where I take a model from this working priest who visited us one summer back in the early 70s, Bernardino Fernandez. He worked as a miner in Spain as a priest. He didn't have a church. He worked with the miners, did what they did, made his living the way the miners did. When they needed to do a service, he'd pull out his little cross and set up and gave them a mass, do whatever they like. That really impacted me. And I figured, why not a ministry like that, where the minister is out there working in the union, working with the workers and ministering to them and their daily needs, mm-hmm. right there on the job, right there in the labor camps, and right there where the need is. So I see that as a different kind of ministry, but trying to speak the values to people around you, surrounding the employers, the labor countries, the crew leaders, the other people, that for their own sake, they ought to treat the people right.
Mm-hmm. Your salary as a leader of FLOC has always been relatively modest, at least compared to some of your contemporaries at other unions. Is that the way you wanted it?
I can't ask for more. What the farm workers make is a pittance. Mm-hmm. Even when they're doing good, it is still not great. It's like people have offered me a lot of opportunities, offered me some, I even had a couple offers to give us a pension. And I said, well, that wouldn't be too good. If I had a pension and the farm workers didn't have any, and how could you lead them? How could you tell them, organize and take this risk and take that risk when you're sitting kind of pretty there? I've got what I need, and to get on with the next day.
As you pointed out, it's about sacrifice in a lot of ways.
Yeah, but that's never bothered me. Tom, I can survive on beans and tortillas. Mm-hmm. I was raised on beans and tortillas for the most part, and if I have to go back to that, I'll go back to that. It's still one of my favorite foods, so.
Well, without question, labor relations certainly have changed over the years that you've been involved in the field, and we see far fewer strikes these days than we did, it seems, in the 40s, 50s, 60s. Why do you think that is?
I don't know whether it's the reticence of unions to be more radical in that respect, but certainly in our case, though, I see the strikes that we had back in the 70s was a lose-lose situation for our people. That the real tension is how the money supply is structured in the supply chain. So if that's the real issue, you go after that, you organize around that. Strikes in agriculture would have minimum impact on any tomato, cucumber company, mm-hmm. because they source the supply internationally. You can have a strike and make some noise, but what's the impact? Was it going to get you to the bargaining table? Mm-hmm. So we have to do what is the more decisive thing to get to the bargaining table.
Is it possible that unions... Perhaps the need for them has diminished at all, that they become perhaps a victim of their own success?
No. Actually, I think there is even a greater need for unions. I believe more strongly, even taking the question outside of unions, there has to be human organization. Everybody has to be a member of something. There has to be a collective. I remember discussing this issue with this businessman here in Toledo, who was very opposed to FLOC and my getting high school kids involved in our marches and demonstrations and so on. And I said, look, I hear you got a problem with my ministry. And he said, so he invited me to lunch to talk about it. I said, okay. He invited me to his country club for lunch. So I go over there, right? I said, well, are you a member of this country club? He says, yeah. I said, why are you a member of this country club? I said, well, because I network here for my business, it's my professional, I better myself here, blah, blah, blah. And I said, do you pay dues? He said, oh, yeah, I pay my annual fee to be a member of this country club. So I bet you're a member of the Chamber of Commerce too, right? So, oh, yeah, yeah, I get a lot of advantage out of that. I bet you're a member of the Kiwanis Club too, right? And all the Lions Club, and hey, members of all these things. I said, how come you white guys can have all these unions and us Mexicans can't have one? The truth is, the union is an association of people, not any different than these professional organizations, corporate organizations that network themselves to better themselves. And everybody should be a member of something, to work collectively with your neighbors and friends to try to make life better for yourself. And hopefully it creates a place where people can come together to reconcile some of the conflicts in a community. So everybody should be a member of something. If people who are born, if they had, should have, they ought to have an automatic card to be not only a Social Security card, they ought to be issued a membership in a church and a membership in an organization.
Now, this gets back a little bit to the issue of sacrifice we talked about, and maybe the nature of the movement and how it's changed. Are younger workers today perhaps less willing to make the sacrifices that you had to make and those who came before you had to make? Are they a little less willing to make that sacrifice?
Well, Tom, there's, you know, it's kind of like I've been doing this for over 40 years, mm-hmm. and I've seen the pendulum go back and forth. There's a generation that rebelled against their parents, and it was all sacrifice, you know, and for the movement, there were the shock troops of the civil rights movement. And then the next generation, the more insulated, protected, and, you know, became more conservative, and then their kids rebelled against them, going back to the other side, and there is I don't know what they call them, Generation X or Generation this, I lost track of all that stuff, but there is a generation that's very self-absorbed, underscored by a guy like LeBron James. It's all about me and what I want. And at some point, those things, that pendulum is going to swing back again.
Do you see that among young Latinos?
I see some of that among some Latinos. And, you know, my job is to remind them where they came from, remind them who created the opportunities that opened the door for them. And that's true of the LeBron James's generation. Mm-hmm. You know, somebody in the black community, remind him who created the opportunities for him to excel, to be where he was, how he got into school, who supported him along the way. And you can't forget where you came from and the roots of where you came from. So it's important that people who went through the struggles, you know, I really enjoy talking to some of the older black folks who were involved in the civil rights movement, to hear their stories about the way they grew up. You know, it's just kind of like, maybe it's nostalgia, I don't know, but I just enjoy listening to them talk about those struggles, and it just gives me more confidence and it increases my footing, so to speak, and keeping on with the struggle.
As a high profile labor leader, you've been involved in a number of other organizations over the years, and you've been on the boards of United Way, University of Toledo. What were those experiences like for you?
Well, those are relatively new experiences for me, and I'm just, when I get on some of those meetings, it's like when I just got on the National Executive Council of the AFL-CIO. My first meeting with them, to see all these powerful labor leaders in one room, and like go to the trustee meeting here in Toledo and the United Way, and see all these movers and shakers sitting around on the table. The amount of power and money in this room is absurd. And if these guys can't move something to better a community, man, nobody can. And so I'm sort of awed by it, really. And you know, sometimes I feel like I'm still looking at things through the windows of a migrant labor shack. And I said, this is pretty awesome here. You know, what if I need to say about this experience, connecting it to these guys, you know, all powerful thoughts about life and community and so mm-hmm. on. I said, this is pretty awesome. This is a pretty awesome opportunity to get this little voice heard in there and maybe get them to address some issues that before they never thought of before.
Mm-hmm. Now, more than just memberships and prestigious organizations have come your way, a lot of folks have recognized your hard work. You've received many well-deserved awards, including the prestigious MacArthur Fellow Prize. Predictably, you gave the cash award, or a good chunk of it, back to the union. What do honors like that mean to you, Baldemar?
Well, first of all, I get astounded by it. And if anything, it makes you feel kind of humbled, because I don't compare myself to some of those other people that have received that award. And I said, there's no way I can be the physicist that this guy who got the award, or that playwright, or that artist over here, my friend Sandra Cisneros, the Latino writer from the right side of San Antonio. I mean, her books are studied at all these universities, including the University of Toledo and Little House on Mango Street. I said, what a phenomenal talent. You know, I feel like that big.
I think you're selling yourself a little short, Baldemar.
No, I don't think so. When I got that award, a member of my mom saying, my siblings were congratulating me on it and everything like that. My mom looks at me and says, well, if I were them, I'd change that award to the Burro Award. You know, the burros are stubborn. He said, because from the time you were little, you're always a stubborn kid. And I fought all these years, and everybody thought I was absolutely crazy trying to break through this multi-party collective bargaining concept, supply chain agreement that we call them now. And so you're a dummy one day for attempting it and doing it, and then you're a genius the next day for achieving it. So it's a lesson in stubbornness, I guess.
Local labor lawyer Jack Gallen, whom you knew very well, once said you have become a labor statesman, I think was his expression. Are you comfortable with that?
I don't know. I just keep on saying what I think is the truth, and if that makes me a statement or a fool, let it drop where it may. But
I think statesman's a term they give us all when we reach a certain age in life, maybe.
Yeah, I guess so.
Any long career like yours, Baldemar, brings a measure of disappointment, I guess. There are things along the way that you wish you could have gotten done. Can you cite anything that, at this point in your life, you're what, 62, 63 years old, 63. That you wish you would have gotten accomplished?
I wish I could have avoided that murder of our staff person in Monterrey. Mm-hmm. That still goes back in my mind how we could have prevented that. You know, did we close that office? Did we give up down there? I mean, it's too dangerous. What do we do? I'm not done processing that through yet. So that's been a big disappointment. Mm-hmm. I'm disappointed that we haven't made more progress nationally on the farm worker issue. Although we enjoy a good relationship with the United Farm Workers in California, the farm worker question, there's still duplicates of that Edward R. Murrow Harvest of Shame being made today. Mm-hmm. And I'm very disappointed that we've not been able to garner a national movement of concern among the public to wipe away that abject poverty in agriculture, which is the country's largest industry. Ohio, it's the largest industry in the state of Ohio. And yet we continue to live with these paltry conditions mm-hmm. of farm workers all over the country. And so I am disappointed in that.
For so long, Baldemar Velasquez was FLOC. For better or worse, you were the guy. Have you put the next generation of FLOC leaders in place?
Well, we're trying very hard for that right now. We got a good core of young people, college graduates, got a young lawyer out of law school, working on their staff full time. They're doing very well. They're managing that entire North Carolina operation. Mm-hmm. And with good expertise, they're bright. Any one of them could take over the union, I think.
Mm-hmm. We haven't talked about your family, and I think we need to do that. And tell us about your wife and children.
Well, my wife is a school nurse at Washington Local Schools. I've grown to love her more and more. She's still very committed and riveted to the cause. She's opened up, her and a friend opened up a tea room in Sylvania. That's becoming very popular. My kids are all going off and succeeding. My oldest daughter got two grandkids. Her husband's an engineer. She's a school teacher. major, double major in biology and chemistry at the University of Toledo. My other daughter, Christiana, works at FLOC as a special projects director. My son, Aaron, is an engineer, magna cum laude graduate at the engineering school at the University of Toledo. He's he runs the pipeline center in Lima for Marathon Oil now. Mm-hmm. And we kidded each other. He said, "Dad, you're going to have to change your opinion about big oil, because I work for one now." I said, "No, son, you have to change yours. You infiltrated them." So, and my youngest daughter is graduated of Schoolcraft College. She's a she's a chef. She got her degree in being a chef, and she's the chef at the tea house. So they're all doing really, really well. Looking forward to getting some more grandkids.
Well, obviously a great source of pride for you, your family. It's difficult for me to imagine that even a more mellow Baldemar Velasquez would ever retire. What do you think?
I don't think anyone can ever retire from a social movement. Mm-hmm. I think we need to take more advantage of some of the veterans of the civil rights movement, the labor movement, and they have a lot to offer, a lot to give, and we need to use them. So to me, the movement is like breathing. It's just what you do. And as long as I can breathe and talk and walk, I'll be trying to promote folks to do this work. Like I said, we got some good young leaders out there right now. I'd like to push them along and give them more responsibility and authority, and coach them through some of the issues they're going to be facing.
Okay. Well, finally, Baldemar, I'm sure that there are going to be a lot of young Latino children down the road watching our conversation, perhaps in the future. What message would you like to leave with them?
The most important, I think, is never let anyone tell you that something is impossible. That be true to your own convictions, and don't let anybody dissuade you from them. And never give up. Remember that most things are possible that are considered impossible if a person doesn't give up. It's only when they give up that things don't come to fruition. Mm-hmm. So as long as you know you don't give up, something eventually has got to give.
Okay. What a nice way to conclude our conversation. Baldemar, thank you so much for the gift of your time today. Good health to you.
Thank you, Tom.
And thank you for watching. We hope you remember to never stop reading and never stop learning.